Hi friends, welcome to SNCA Study Club, a platform for CA final students. We are moving towards the 25th question. PQR and Associate Chartered Accountant have their website on the letterhead. On the form, it has been mentioned that visit our website pqr.com. In the website, the nature of assignment handle, name of the prominent client and fee charge was also displayed. So what is happening here? PQR, a firm of Chartered Accountant, they started they created a website, and in the letterhead of the concerned PQR firm, they are providing that please visit our website, etc. And they are providing the nature of assignment, client's information and fee which has been charged from the client, etc. So which is the relevant clause that is providing with respect of website? Yeah, clause 6, part 1, first schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he solicit client or professional work either directly or indirectly through circular, advertisement, personal communication or interview, or through any means which is not open to a chartered accountant. So here what is happening? They started or they created a website. So first of all, there is no restriction with respect of creation of website, the format of website, the color, the letters that has been used or the font style. These are all depends upon the taste and the preference of the concerned chartered accountant. There is no council guidelines that is restricting with respect of the format, name and what other related, so such as what to. That is, the concerned firm or chartered accountants may create website in attractive manner. It is depends upon their creativity. Council has not created or council has not issued any guidelines that is restricting with respect of such matters regarding the website. So here what is happening? So first of all, we have to indicate that the website should be run on pull mode and not on push mode. That is, it has to be in pull mode and not on push mode. Plus, the website should not be in the nature of soliciting client. Website shall not solicit client or professional work. Plus, in the given case, what is happening? That is, we are providing with respect of the question. In the question, the PQR firm has created a website and the letterhead of the concerned PQR firm has provided that visit our website. Then they are also provided the nature of assignment, client's information and fee which has been charged from the clients in the website of the concerned firm. So here they are providing these kind of information on the website. So we have to determine whether it is permitted or not. Can they tell the clients in the letterhead that visit our website? It is just like what? Solicitation. So question, first of all, we have to indicate the question, then whether it is soliciting or not. It is in a manner of solicitation. It is soliciting the client. Then what is happening? The nature of assignment. They are providing in the website what? The nature of assignment. That is, they are expert in this field or they are handling this work. They are having a track record of carrying of these types of works, etc. So usually a firm of chartered accountant or chartered accountant shall not provide such informations in the website unless otherwise a pull request is made. So nature of assignment only on pull request mode. That is not on push. That is, they are telling the client, come, please come here and use our website to understand the natural services that we are providing, etc. So what should be actually happened? The client have to come to the website and the client have to make a request to understand what are the services or which are the services that has been provided by the concerned entity. Then what is happening? They are providing the client's information, who are the prominent client and what is the fee that has been charged from the client. So usually it is not allowed. So client info plus fee charged from client, it is not allowed unless law or regulation ask the same. Plus disclosure of this information only up to requirement made by law or regulation. So here what is happening? The last one is the conclusion. Here no law or regulation has not asked such information, plus they soliciting the client or professional work. So what is happening? They will be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct. This is the answer. Okay, so now we are moving towards the next question, that is 25b. okay, 25b. Mr. B is a practicing chartered accountant holding valid certificate of practice. He accepted the appointment as director of a Green World Company Limited. Mr. C, a partner of Mr. B, is a statutory auditor of the said company. So what is happening here? Suppose this is the firm of chartered accountants A, B, C. In the given question, B is appointed as the director of the company, where C is the auditor. So we have to determine whether the concerned chartered accountants are deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct or not. This is the question. Okay, so first of all, we have to determine whether D, that is sorry, B, who has been appointed as a director of a company, can such practicing chartered accountant engage in any business or profession? So first of all, we have to mention that clause. Which is the clause? Clause 11, part 1, first schedule, right? Which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he engages in any business or occupation other than the profession of chartered accountancy without or unless or without obtaining the permission of the council so to engage. So here what is happening? We have to check one more thing, general permission and as well as specific permission and prior approval. Specific permission and prior approval, right? Prior permission, specific approval. But at the same time, to become a director, to become a director of a company, generally permitted by the council, right? Generally, general permission has been granted by our council. So in that case, it is a practicing chartered accountant is not required to obtain specific approval of the council. But what is happening here? But company or entity where any partner is appointed as the auditor, in that case specific approval and prior permission is required. But in the given case, it has been not provided in the question whether the B has obtained the specific approval and prior permission. So these are the first thing, that first clause and first matter that you have to indicate. Then second one is that what is happening here? He is the statutory auditor and he is expressing an opinion on the financial statement where a partner have substantial interest, deemed substantial interest. We have already stated that in case if it is a firm, if the if any of the partner of the firm is appointed as the director or member or owner of a concern, in that case it shall the concerned partner shall have deemed, that is deemed substantial interest in that concern. So in that case, firm is not, or firm or any partner of the firm shall not express an opinion on the financial statement. So one more clause, clause 4, part 1, second schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he expresses an opinion on the financial statements of an entity, that is a business or entity, where he himself or any partner of the firm has substantial interest. So in the given case, partner of firm, that is B, is the director of the company, it means that there exists what? Substantial interest. Then we have to examine the question. What is happening in the question? We have to explain the same. Last one, conclusion. Plus indicate 141 subsection 3 clause C, which is stating that if a partner or employee of officer or employee of the company, in that case what, the concerned firm shall not be appointed as an auditor of the company. So here what is happening? one of the partner of the firm is having what? One of the partner is the officer or employee of the company. So these are the matters that is to be indicated. Plus indicate, that is what should be done by Mr. C. Auditor should. 141 subsection 4, that is vacate the office. He have to vacate the office. 141 subsection 4. Done. Not done. In case not done, C shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct, and B is held for deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct because he has not obtained specific approval and prior permission of the council. Okay, few people may not understand 141 subsection 3. Why I mentioned 141 subsection 3 clause C? This is what? 141 subsection 3 clause B. This is 141 subsection 3 clause B, and this is what? 141 subsection 3 clause C. Here which is stating that employee or officer of a company shall not be eligible to appoint as an auditor of the company. Here partner, employee of officer of a company shall not be eligible to appoint as an auditor of the company. So I will give you an example. Suppose A, who is a practicing chartered accountant, he is the employee of the company. Or officer, or he is appointed as a director of that company. So in that case, he shall not be eligible to appoint as the auditor. A is not eligible to appoint as auditor, right? Auditor. Then the next question is, can ABC firm appointed as the auditor of the company? What is happening here? A is the employee of the company. Then can B appoint as the auditor of the company? This is the question. So in this case, we have to apply 141 subsection 3 clause C, where it has been stated that partner or employee of the officer. Here B, who is B? He is the partner of A. A means employee of the company. So in the given case, B is also ineligible to appoint as an auditor of the company. If he is accepted the position of an auditor in the company, he has to vacate the office. That is 141 subsection 4. Okay, dears, we are moving towards 25C. YK is a partnership firm of CA, was appointed to concurrent auditor of a bank. YK has used their influence for getting some check purchased and thereafter failed to repay the loan or overdraft. So here what is happening? Bank was appointed as the the firm has been appointed as the concurrent auditor of the bank, and they use their influence to purchase some check, that is to obtain some loans, etc., but they failed to make the repayment of the same format ABC, that is what clause, question, and last one is the conclusion. So which is the relevant clause? What is happening here? They had taken loan because of their position in the bank and fails to make the repayment. So it is not in the technical capacity. It means this is not what? Professional misconduct. So first of all, you have to indicate section 21, right? It is stating that disciplinary actions can be taken against a member of institute if he is found guilty of professional misconduct or other misconduct. Plus other misconduct, what he is doing in this question, he is taking loan and not making the repayment. It is just like what? Bringing disrepute to our profession, right? So which is the clause 2, part 4, first schedule, which is stating that CA, that is a member of institute, shall be deemed to be guilty of other misconduct if in the opinion of counsel he bring disrepute to our profession or institution by his action or as a result of his action, whether or not related to the professional work, but which has been done in the professional capacity, right? So here he is what doing. So first of all, you have to indicate section 21 and clause 2, part 4, first schedule. Then what is happening in the question? Here they had taken loan from the bank and fails to make the repayment of the loan. So last one, they are guilty of other misconduct. Disciplinary actions can be taken against the firm. So we are moving towards the next question, 25D. Mr. Mohan, a practicing chartered accountant, issued certificate of consumption which did not reflect the correct factual position of the consumption of raw material by the concerned entity. It is found that the certificate is given on the basis of data appearing in the minutes meeting of the board. So here what is they are doing? Issuing certificate of consumption of raw material, but this does not reflect what actual position. That is, this information or this report has been given by the practicing chartered accountant on the basis of information appearing in the minute. So few people may think that information, it means clause 8 of part 1 second schedule, which is stating that, but actually it is not clause 8. It is not clause 8. First of all, it is not clause 8. As per clause 8, CA and practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he fails to obtain sufficient information to express an opinion on the financial statement. Right? And the absence of such information is sufficient to negate the expression of opinion. This is what expression of opinion on the financial statement. And they didn't get the information. So in this case, he is not expressing an opinion on the financial statement. They are providing a report, or they are certifying, they are issuing what certificate. So the which are the relevant clause that is similar in this case, that is with respect of this question. First one, clause 2 part 1 second schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct If he certify or submit a report on examination of financial statement where such examination is not done by himself, partner, employee or other practicing chartered accountant. So here what is actually happened? They didn't examine the records, related records with respect of identifying the actual consumption of raw material. Only because of that, they were not in a position to reflect what the correct position. The CA failed in their professional duty. So one more clause, CA failed in professional duty. One more clause, which is that clause? Clause 7 part 1 second schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he fails to exercise due diligence or grossly negligent in his professional duty. So he is what? Grossly negligent, because he has used only the information as per the minute. He has not made a proper examination of other records and related record. So then question plus CA didn't examine related records and documents. So conclusion, deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct. This is the answer. Okay. Moving towards 26th question. XYZ Limited appoint you as the auditor of the company. You observe that the previous auditor A and Co. resigned. Also, balance sheet at 31st March 2016 shows an audit fee payable of 25,000. What precautions you should take before commencing the audit work? This is the question. So XYZ Limited, it is a company appointing you as the auditor. You as the auditor. Previous auditor Y and Co. was resigned. Plus balance sheet has shown that audit fee payable 25,000. Okay. So what are the precautions that is to be undertaken by the concerned chartered accountant? So we have to indicate what? This is not the same format ABC. We have to indicate relevant clause and as well as the sections of the company set and the matters to be complied by the incoming auditor. Okay. So first of all, we have to determine 140 subsection 2 and 3. That is whether the predecessor auditor has filed the prescribed form in the prescribed format. Right? It means that prescribed form means, I think it is ADT 3. ADT 3 has been filed by the predecessor auditor within a period of 30 days from the date of resignation, containing the facts and other matters that is relevant to the resignation. ADT 3 by predecessor auditor. So auditor, that is auditor shall file a statement in form ADT 3 within a period of 30 days from the date of resignation with the registrar stating that reasons and facts that is relevant for the resignation. So it is the responsibility of the incoming auditor to check whether the predecessor auditor has complied with the same. Then what are the next matter that is to be complied? Suppose it has to be submitted to the registrar. Suppose if it is a government company, the same have to be filed to the Comptroller and Auditor General. Then compliance with what? Section 142 and 140 subsection 3. Okay, that is 140 subsection 2 and 140 subsection 3. Then the second condition, suppose the position of an auditor is become vacant because of what? Casual vacancy. So resulting is what? Casual vacancy. So he have to ensure that his appointment is done by the company as per which is the section 139 subsection 8. That is within a period of 30 days from the rate of resignation they can fill the vacancy. But if such a vacancy, casual vacancy, is on account of resignation of an auditor, the same has to be approved within a period of 3 months in the general meeting. So they have to ensure that their appointment is done as per section 139 subsection 8, that is filling of casual vacancy, and the same have to be approved by the members in the annual general meeting within a period of 3 months, right? Then the third one, auditor have to obtain NOC from predecessor auditor, right? The auditor must obtain NOC from the predecessor auditor. He should also refer the resignation statement filed by the previous auditor and communicate with him to ascertain the circumstances which led up to retire, plus examine reason of his resignation, right? Examine what? The reason for the resignation. This is also required to be done. Then what he has to be done? He has to furnish a certificate as per section 139. So as to ensure that his appointment, or he is appointing as an auditor of a company in according to section 141 subsection 3 clause G. Certificate by incoming auditor or new auditor. For easiness, I have that is to become a simplicity, because I can't write the whole answer here. I just giving what hint. Then he have to determine circumstances that warrant not to accept the audit engagement. Then he should also have to ensure that the appointment, that is clause 8 part 1 first schedule, that is communication has to be done, registered post acknowledgement due within a reasonable time, etc. Then one more thing, clause 9 part 1 first schedule, he has to ensure that his appointment is done by complying with the provisions of section 139, 140 and 141 of the Companies Act 2000 Amendment Act has come. Okay, so these are the matters that is to be ensured by the incoming auditor while accepting the appointment as an auditor of the company. We are moving towards 27th question. 27, give your comments with reference to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949 and schedules thereto. CA Smart practicing chartered accountant was in Europe between 15th September 2016 and 25th September 2016. On 18th September 2016, a message was received from the client requesting for to certify a stock, that is to request for a stock certificate to be produced to the bank for the purpose of getting loan. Due to urgency, CA Smart directed his assistant, who is also a chartered accountant, to sign and issue the stock certificate after due verification on his behalf. So here Yes, he's on foreign tour. He is receiving what? A letter from the client to sign a stock certificate. He is authorizing his employee, who is also a chartered accountant, to sign the same. So ABC format, ABC format. Relevant clause, which is the relevant clause? Clause 12, part 1, first schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he if he allow a person who is not a member of institute or member of institute but not his partner to sign and certify a report on examination of financial statement, that is a report on examination of balance sheet, profit and loss account, or what, a report on what, financial statements, etc. Okay, that is, or to sign on financial statement also. So here what he has done, what is happening in the question, he has authorized what? Employee who is member but not his partner. Hence, conclusion, he will be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct. This is the answer. So here we have completed what? 27th A portion. Moving towards the 27th B question, which is stating that a letter is sent by a chartered accountant in practice to the Ministry of Finance inquiring whether a panel of auditor is being maintained by the ministry, and if so, include the name in the panel. So here, auditor, that is the chartered accountant, is sending a letter to the panel, that is that is Ministry of Finance, that whether there exists a panel, that is whether you maintain a panel. If you are maintaining such a panel, please have your our name also. So which is the relevant clause? Clause 6, part 1, first schedule, which is stating that CA in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he solicit his professional work or client either directly or indirectly through circular, advertisement, personal communication, interview. First you have to indicate this, then the same clause already provided empanelment. That is, the chartered accountants may have their name on the panel which has been maintained by the institute, etc. But at the same time, you should have the knowledge with respect of the existence of the panel. So B, what is happening in the question? What is happening in the question? Then empanelment, that is, they can have their name on the panel which has been maintained by the several institutions or ministry or different departments, etc. But for one condition, they should have the knowledge with respect of the existence of the panel. They shall not make roving query, that is, whether their name is included, whether there exists any panel, etc. So here the concerned firm is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct. This is the answer. Okay.